Reflections of a Black Mother. Mirrors aren't designed to reflect what's inside. At best, they display superficial layers of loveliness or ugliness, cropped, propped, and photoshopped images exposed for those we naively believe care or matter. But internalized blemishes fester and reflect beyond what mere silver nitrate can capture. Gnarled and corroded viscera cannot contain the self-hate rising from insidiously implanted projections, where even children's images no longer reflect innocence. So deep and inescapable is the pain that esteem and pride are erased and replaced with rage. This is the shadowy abyss in which too often Black children are raised. Although my mirror may not reflect it, this is my reflection. Unless this legacy ends, blemishes will fester in America's soul until the day she implodes.
License and registration, he can sense your aggravation.
On the head of the fallen angel.
I mean, this is a team effort. Remind me to keep going.
Time, my shirt.
Did you know that your hands came with a ripple effect?
Like so.
We got the same dreams. I mean, blood, sweat, and tears win by any means, poetry.
Sway, look at me. Is a piece of the pie too good for me? I mean,
some may call it rock the mic. We call it poetry.
Hello. Welcome to Sojourn with Words. I'm your host, Sistah Joy. And today we are so excited because we're actually debuting, even though we've been on the air 15 years, we're debuting the virtual Sojourn with Words. So this is the time that we're living in, and we're moving full steam ahead. I'm excited because I have, oh my gosh, one of the icons, one of the literary icons of the DMV and beyond, I'm sure. I'm very honored to welcome today Ethelbert Miller, E. Ethelbert Miller, if I may. And let me share a little bit about him. Ethelbert is the author of two memoirs and several books of poetry, including The Collected Poems of E. Ethelbert Miller, a comprehensive collection that represents over 40 years of work. Now, for 17 years, Ethelbert has served as the editor of, he did serve as the editor of Poet Lore, the oldest poetry magazine published in the United States. His poetry has been translated into a dozen languages. He is a two-time Fulbright Senior Specialist Program Fellow to Israel. He holds an honorary degree of Doctor of Literature from Emory and Henry College and has taught at several universities. Many of you may know him from the weekly WPFW morning radio show On the Margin with E. Ethelbert Miller. And he's also the host of The Scholars on UDCTV, which received a 2020 Telly Award. Now, I'm gonna stop there because with this guest, we could be sharing his bio and credits, literary and otherwise, for the entire half hour that we will be on air. But please join me in welcoming to Sojourn with Words, E. Ethelbert Miller. Ethelbert, welcome.
Well, thank you very much. It's good to see you again.
It's been a while, yes. that invisible border between Maryland and Washington, D.C. does its job. I mean, really. But we're keeping up with what you've been doing as best we can. And we know that you're doing much, not just in the DMV, but throughout the country, at least. And although, you know, we're all put on pause with regard to traveling these days, Ethelbert, tell us a little bit about what's happening currently. We'll back up from the present, but tell us what's happening currently with the work that you're doing as a literary activist. And well, how about we first tell folks, what is a literary activist?
Well, you know, Joy, I use that term. I pretty much coined that term. What I try to say is that it's an outgrowth of my activism in general. But what I try to be is a literary advocate. For many years, I worked behind the scenes with different organizations. I served on the board. So, you know, being an advocate for literature is very important. But in terms of being a literary activist, you know, the other thing I put pride in is promoting other people's work. Whether that's my students, whether that's people that I encounter when I visit the campus, or even if I go to a prison, that's important, promoting people's work. But the main thing I do as a literary activist is I put an emphasis on documenting literary history. And this is why, you know, I have a very extensive archives at the Gilman Library at George Washington University, which is not just about my work, but about, you know, people that I have encountered. Back in the 70s, I kept a file on almost every writer that I met, and that has proved very helpful to scholars. You know, I'll give you an example. One very important writer who lived in our area was Essex Hemphill, and very important, especially to the Black gay community. I always felt that Essex was as important to the Black gay community as Audre Lorde was. And so, you know, to compile material, you know, on Essex from the time he started writing, has proven very valuable. Just recently, I've been in correspondence with an African woman who is residing in Switzerland, and she is studying and writing about, you know, Essex Hemphill's work, and I've been able to provide her with that work. And I can go down the list of people that you know. I have a file on you, for example, and I think that's important, because what happens is that, you know, many of us can be writing today. But I always use the 1920s as an example of the Harlem Renaissance, the New Negro Movement. Why do we only know about Langston Hughes and County Cullen and Claude McKay? There were other people that write. And so I feel that in many ways, I can correct that, at least during my lifetime, that there might be a folder that I have at the Gilman Library that somebody years from now will say, wow, you know, so-and-so was a very important writer and we didn't know about them. Well, right. We do now because, you know, someone kept files on it.
Right. And I totally embrace that reality. Many of our viewers here on Sojourn with Words know that I'm the founder of Collective Voices. Right. And I take great pride and honor the fact that over the 20 years that Collective Voices hosted Poetry Extravaganza, we presented an artist roster of over 200 poets, musicians, and visual artists, dancers, artisans of all types. And it's about embracing that community of arts. So what you're talking about is definitely keeping the record for from time immemorial. How about that? I'll get it right. But we thank you for that. I have to say I'm a bit hesitant to even ask what might be in my file. But when we talk,
but you've been adding to that, you know, when you talk about your group, you know, very involved in terms of things at the Gilman Library, you know, and that was an outgrowth of my work. You know, I went over there and created that literary archive with the intention that it would not just be my work, but it would be other writers, literary organizations would have a place to deposit their material.
And that's very much the path that we, when we find ourselves in positions of leadership, we have to understand and embrace the reality that this is not a solo sojourn. Right. Certainly in my work as poet laureate for Prince George's County, there's much that is about bringing to the fore those voices that are underrepresented currently. And I'll put this out there right now for the community that may be viewing this episode. We're making a concerted effort to connect with poets, Latinx, and Hispanic multicultural voices that are in Prince George's County but are not coming to the fore for whatever reason. Certainly in the county, Sojourn with Words has been on for 15 years. And I believe we've had, one Native American, certainly, you know, a diversity between, you know, black and white, but we've not heard, and Prince George's County has a broad base, Hispanic base that we know exists. We want to connect with that artist community as well. So for all you viewers who are out there, if mm-hmm. you are among those that we're trying to connect with, please reach out to CTV, to Sistah Joy, to Sojourn with Words. We're on Facebook. We're at this point now, we're even on Twitter, heaven forbid I stepped into that pool. But we want everyone to understand that the poetry community is very multifaceted, and we want all the voices to be represented. So step up and let us know what you're doing, and let us know how we can support you.
You know, when you say that, Joy, you know, the other thing that ties in with your work is what you see happening across the country. And that is, today we have quite a number of poet laureates in various cities and various states. What has been really important is the work that Elizabeth Alexander has done as head of the Mellon Foundation, which is to provide money for these various poet laureates to serve their communities. And I think this really started when we changed from the poetry consultant to the poet laureate at the Library of Congress.
Right.
And what the Library of Congress wanted to do was, you know, it was nice to have someone like Robert Penn Warren, you know, who was the first poet laureate. But, you know, you wanted somebody like a Rita Dove who was going to be an advocate and go around and travel. And yeah. So what you see happening is that, like with yourself, if you have a poet laureate, whether it's at the Library of Congress or in a different community, you want that person not just sit at home and write their own poems. You want them to go out and encourage other writers, you know, build bridges with other communities. And I think this is a group like yourself doing a wonderful public service.
Well, thank you for that. Now, Ethelbert, you have a history that's steeped in academia.
That's like saying I was a slave on a plantation for many years.
Well, we know that
we can look at it that way.
We know that you paid your dues and the dues of a whole lot of other folks, and we appreciate the contribution. But tell us, when you talk about your teaching career, I know I have information here about you know Bennington, your University of Nevada, Las Vegas, University of Texas, Victoria, of course, Howard. Talk to us about why is it important for you to give the way you do in schools and in the...
Well, I think it's important for me to, if anybody looking at my life, to look at my teaching, because many people associate me with Howard University. And I always tell people, I was not on the faculty at Howard. I did not teach at Howard. You know, somebody might come by the resource center and I, you know, read their work, but I was not teaching a class. So when I look at my students at the Bennington Writing Seminar, my students are at UNLV, and I take pride in that. And then the other thing, which is very important in terms of issues of race, the majority of my students are white or Korean, they're not African American. And I say that because everybody immediately associates me with African American literature. But when I look at the people that I taught, you know, because I was in programs at Bennington, but I was the only black faculty member there, you know, and the black students who came through there, like, you know, Amika Bingham, you know, is very important. I look at Tracy Guzio, who was one of my students at UNLV, and I introduced Tracy to the work of John Wideman. And she is an expert on John Wideman's work. You know, years later, she's a professor at University of Plattsburgh, upstate New York. And I say that in terms of one, you know, people looking at me at Howard, but, you know, I was pretty much affiliated with other institutions, like Embry and Henry, for example. I was there for a period of time and created an archive of my work at that institution. Many people might connect me with Minneapolis. I mean, there's a woman that's on the city council there who's one of my students there. And I just look at that in terms of take pride in that and emphasizing it, because sometimes people forget that I was teaching at some of these institutions.
Okay. Well, I have to say, as long as I've known you, I never knew that you were not an instructor.
Right.
At Howard.
I'm not, right.
I wouldn't put money on it.
Well, you know.
But I guess that Ascension series at Howard is what connects for many in the community. That was a series that you hosted. Speak a little bit about that.
Oh, yeah, Ascension was started, and have to go back, you know, to Howard University changing, you know, and I always tell people, you can talk about the Harlem Renaissance, New Negro Movement, you know, the 20s, whatever. I felt that when I was at Howard in the early 70s, that period of time, like 72, 73, 74, was a very, like a golden era. You know, I was on the campus when it was like Leon DeMoss and Stoney Brown. And what happens is that I was working with one of my mentors, Dr. Stephen Henderson, who became head of the Institute for Arts and Humanities. And in that organization or that unit, we were documenting African-American experience. And I remember going to him and saying, well, it's nice that we're bringing all these famous writers here, but maybe I can support writers in the community and the campus, right, by starting a reading series. And he said, yeah, sure. And the key thing about that first Ascension reading was people got paid. It wasn't a lot of money, but people got paid, you know? Right. And I think Stephanie Stokes, who went on to become editor of Essence Magazine, one of the readers there. Okay. And, you know, she got her start. Then the Ascension number 3 was very important, because that's when I got into the whole thing of having a guest poet. And the guest poet who came down for Ascension number 3 was Lucille Clifton.
Oh, my.
Right. And Lucille Clifton only came down because another person who I spent a lot of time, every time I mention, you know, it's also like Marx and Engels, I always mention Amazu Bolton. Because when our lives connected in 73, 74, you know, we changed literary history in terms of Washington, D.C. and the surrounding area, because Amos came into this city from the South, and he always introduced himself as a publisher. And because I was doing the Ascension series, all of a sudden, we could present people and have a reading for them and then publish their work. So, you know, and then Amos was in the whole thing of like, you know, okay, I know Hakeem Madhubuti's here, Don Lee, whatever, you know, he said that we should be self-sufficient, but Amos was the person to say, I'm going to go downtown to the Arts Commission and get the white money so I could do my projects, you know?
Right.
And so he got into grant proposals, and to make a long story short, we, with the support of the DC Arts Commission, I think Larry Neal was heading it at that time, we got money to do Synergy, the first Black anthology of DC, you know, writers. And that would never have been done if I hadn't met Amazu Bolton. And we wouldn't have had writers to, you know, contact if I hadn't had the Ascension series.
So it all folds in together.
It all folds together, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And seeing what you said earlier about what you're doing in PG County, about reaching out to the Latino community, after a while, and I saw that, you know, that for a new writer who didn't have a book, the reading series was very important that he or she could reach an audience.
Right.
And then I did something which I guess was radical. I saw what impact I was having in DC. I said, well, let me move beyond DC. Let me give some of these writers in New York their first reading outside of the area. And then from different nationalities, Kamiko Hahn, Pedro Petre, you know, Sandy Estevez. I mean, I brought all these writers because, you know, I knew them. You know, I was from New York and you know, grew up in the Puerto Rican neighborhood. And so I knew I'm going to bring Pedro Petri and Sandy Stevens, you know, to D.C. And that was very helpful to them. And then one other writer who I gave a first reading who would go on to create other things, and that was Cornelius Eady. You know, he'll tell the story all the time. You know, Cornelius Eady was working up there in New Jersey somewhere, and I sent him a letter to come on. And his first book, I said Cartoons with a, you know, K-R-T-U-N-E-S. I gave him his first reading. He never forgot that. And when you see how him and Toy Derricotte would create Copy Condom, you know, he'll tell you that I had a lot to do with his thinking. And so that's where our lives are connected.
Well, you certainly have made many inroads for poetry, certainly in the communities that I'm aware of, and clearly well beyond my knowledge. But when we talk about books, mm-hmm. let's talk about your forthcoming The Little Book of Eve.
The Little Book of Eve, yeah.
Yeah, tell us about that.
I got The Little Book of Eve right here. I mean, this is The Little Book of Eve.
Oh, you know, literally.
It is little. But I mean, this is little because I write in it. But what happened, and just you might have been affected, well, everybody's been affected by the COVID. You know, what happens is that because I wasn't going out, because I was in my house, and you know, I'm fortunate that I have a house. Some of my friends are in apartments. But I was able to, you know, you know, not go out. And then really after a while, I didn't really want to go out. But I had been working in terms of, you know, changing my backyard. So I had like a little Zen path back there, had a little Buddha I created, a place to go people and I could go out and meditate. But I also thought about solitude, loneliness. And I came back and I started looking at the person who was very important in my life, who died very early in his life. And that was my brother. You know, my brother Richard went into the monastery in upstate New York in the early 60s. And that was a spiritual undertaking. And only because my mother could not accept it that she, you know, negotiated to pull him out of the monastery. But I looked at that. I said, wow, my brother, at a very early age, was going to take, you know, become a Trappist monk. So, you know, you were really making a commitment. Wow. And I started reading my Thomas Merton while I was in my backyard. And then I started writing haiku. And I'm writing haiku because what happens is that sitting in my yard, I was connecting with nature.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden I said, wow, you know, and I'm reading Thomas Merton, I'm reading Hazrat Inayat Khan, you know, Sufi writers. So this whole spiritual thing, which I think a lot of people during COVID began to really have to wrestle with that because, mm-hmm. you know, people around them, loved ones were dying and you begin to sense, okay, who am I? Why am I here? And you pay more and more attention, you know, to little birds flying around, the squirrels and things. And that's when I decided, let me write the haiku. Because it forced me to deal with that moment, to really capture what I was seeing, feeling, and hearing.
Okay, so maybe we could hear
some. Yeah, and I'll give you a couple.
Yeah,
and then what happened, and this is, you know, you mentioned my, in introducing me, you know, I had a Fulbright, two Fulbrights to Israel. And during one of those trips to Israel, I met a woman by the name of Joanna Chen. And, you know, when we talk about writers and close writers, Joanna Chen is one of my close writers, even though she lives in Israel. And what happens is that many times we Skype, we share poems back and forth, you know, and Joanna Chen had translated some of my work into Hebrew. So when I started working on this little book of Eel, my writing my haikus, I shared some of my haikus with Joanna. And so she said, oh, I'd like to, you know, maybe translate these. And then she had a friend, Rafi Ellison, who she said, okay, I'm going to give these poems to Rafi to translate. So make a long story short. The little book of E is my haiku in English and Hebrew. And I'm working with Rafi Ellison, who lives in Boston now, who's studying to be a rabbi. His mother's a rabbi, his father's a rabbi. He's studying to be a rabbi. Guy's brilliant. And we hit it off immediately. So what happens is that he has taken like about 100 of the haikus I've gotten ready. He's broken them down. And the ones he likes are the jazz haiku. And I'll read you three jazz haiku.
Okay.
And this one is, and I'll talk a little bit about it too. This is number 15.
Before you start the poem, can you just introduce
okay.
A haiku is
a short poem, you know, Japanese poem that form in terms of you know, many people associate it with that culture. It's 17 syllables. You can think of three lines, 5, 7, 5. Many times the haiku focuses on nature, but it doesn't have to be. And it doesn't have to necessarily be 5, 7, 5 in terms of syllables. Many people have been very, you know, just like with sonnets, you know, they've stretched the form. But I've been very strict in terms of 5, 7, 5 in terms of syllables. And then one person who I did draw inspiration from was Richard Wright, because during his last years, yes. Richard Wright wrote thousands of haiku.
Yeah, and I so, had one of those of haiku.
Right, the other world. And what happened, by coincidence, this is a literary activist but coming back. By coincidence, what happened, I pulled that book off the shelf. And I have a bad habit of sticking letters in books, right? So I pulled this book, I'm writing a haiku, I'm going to read Richard Wright's haiku. And in the book, because it was a galley, was a letter from the publisher saying, well, Ellen Wright said you have to have this book, and we're rushing this book to you. This is Richard Wright's wife, you know. And I had forgotten that I had communicated with Ellen Wright. I knew I had communicated with his daughter, Julia Wright.
Julia, yeah.
You know, but I had forgotten. When was I communicating with Ellen Wright? But that was in there. And I felt a certain spiritual thing that, okay, this letter falls out, you know, and so you're supposed to be writing haiku because, you know, you're continuing this tradition. So, and then I'm writing these jazz haiku because Rafi, who's translating, he says, I like the jazz haiku. So here's three jazz haiku, and they just have numbers.
Okay.
I'll read them in the order of the numbers. 13, haiku number 13. So dizzy the world, climate change is the new jazz. Can you dance to it? Haiku number 14. Yes, a love supreme. Coltrane places horn to lips, beauty out of man. Haiku number 15. Gone is the lush life. Now will you take the A train? I love you madly. Now each one of those jazz haiku, if you know jazz, you know that there's some very interesting things happening, like the last one I read. Gone is the lush life. Now will you take the A train? I love you madly. Well, lush life is Billy Strayhorn, who collaborated quite a bit with Duke Ellington. In fact, I think Duke met, remember, Billy Strayhorn in Pittsburgh, where he's from, and said, okay, if you come to New York, look me up. And so basically, Billy Strayhorn composes Take the A Train. You know, so that's how the competition, that's how the competition ran. And then, you know, after many concerts, Duke Ellington would say, I love you madly. You know, it was like a signature statement. So in that, you know, you have this Billy Strayhorn and Duke Ellington in this short haiku. The same way, for example, many of us, when we think of John Coltrane, we think of A Love Supreme, which is a very spiritual composition. So in my haiku, I say, yes, A Love Supreme, Coltrane places horn to lips, beauty out of man. The key line is beauty out of man.
Beauty out of man.
Yes, ma'am. So that's how those are. They're short poems, and you've probably written short poems also, Joy. And what you find is that many times they're compact. They're ones that sometimes if you're at a reading, like, you know, if I read a haiku in public, you know, usually I read it twice, that people will get a full sense of the taste of it.
Yes.
Well, you know, you were talking about family, you know, and children. And so I'll read this next poem, which is important to me. It's called Black Men Are Precious. And the first time I read this in public was on the day that Congressman Elijah Cummings died.
Oh.
And so, you know, I was reading in Tacoma Park, Maryland, since I was in Maryland, and Elijah Cummings was congressman from Maryland. I dedicated the poem to him. And then I also reflect back on the fact that I remember when Elijah Cummings was at Howard, you know, student government. I used to tease him about that. But, you know, I decided to, you know, I thought about Elijah Cummings. And then I read a poem, I read this poem again. And At that time, I dedicated to Kobe Bryant. You know, because of just Black men in their lives. So this is Black Men Are Precious.
Okay.
Black men, Black friends having strokes, Black men younger than me, good men with bad hearts, men who did not follow their fathers in the factories or the post office, Black men who went off to college and pulled themselves up by degrees, men who did not sink into despair, but lifted their families into new homes, Black men who survived the bullets, streets, and police. Black men who saw the horizon and the stars. They marched as if Garvey held out his hand, not to Ethiopia, but to our hearts. Black hearts, now failing for unknown reasons. Why? Why do we die so young? Why are we not like our grandfathers, sitting on the porch, rocking away the years? Why are we not the Black men returning from the wars and lifting our girlfriends up into wives again? Why do we date this early death? After all the exercise and pills, after the changing diet, why is there such a cruel hunger that appears and takes our years? Black men, my friends resting in their open coffins, waiting for someone to sing, Precious Lord, and take their hand. Black hands closing with so much love still left to give.
So much. Thank you. Thank you. That was beautiful.
Thank you.
Is that in the little book of E?
No. What happens is the little book of E is just going to be 50 haiku in English English and Hebrew. But the other, you know, I have a unpublished manuscript. Well, you may reference an introduction to my collected work, which is edited by Kirsten Porter, who's my literary assistant. Every poem that I write, and I'm writing every day, goes immediately into what we call section 15, because the collected poems has 14 sections. The 15th section is on Kirsten's computer. That's where section 15 goes.
Well, once again, we have whizzed through our time. I hope you have enjoyed the time that we shared here today with E. Ethelbert Miller. Ethelbert, thank you so much.
Oh, thank you for the invitation. Thank you for sharing your work with me.
Absolutely. And please, we hope that our viewers will stay tuned to Sojourn with Words, which airs now twice, sometimes three times weekly on CTV, based in Prince George's County, Maryland, We want everyone to, number one, keep writing,